Hi, I'm Jack Barnes, President and CEO of People's United Bank. I'm here in the center of Westport, a city many cultural institutions and successful artists call home. People's United Bank is proud to support the communities where we live and work. That's why we're supporting CPTV and the many Connecticut cultural treasures they will be featuring over the coming months. Look for stories each week featuring cultural treasures in your neighborhood.
The Roman philosopher Seneca had a pretty smart take on the value of culture. He argued that our minds need to be cultivated in order to grow, and that culture was a key ingredient. Hi, I'm Edward Zbicki, and here in Connecticut, the arts and culture are a big part of the fabric of our lives. And our treasures, they can help us become wiser, sharper, and just a little bit healthier. In this episode of Connecticut's Cultural Treasures, learn about the Hudson River School artists and much more at the Wadsworth Athenaeum. We'll travel to revolutionary Wethersfield and meet America's first secret diplomat. We'll visit the best of nature at East Rock State Park. We'll learn from some young people at the Whitfield State Museum. We'll also visit one of the oldest historical societies in Connecticut. From the ancient to the mysterious, something sensual or completely nuts, a trip to the museum is about more than just admiring great art. It should be a great adventure.
I really believe that museums are active places where you're thinking very, very hard about what you're looking at, but also your emotions are going.
Here at the Wadsworth Athenaeum in downtown Hartford, each masterpiece aims to draw you in and to open you up to new perceptions about the world and about yourself.
When one comes to a museum, my hope is that not only will you learn something, but that you really will be transformed in some way.
With bragging rights as the nation's first public art museum, the Athenaeum opened its doors in 1842. Since, it's built an impressive history of artistic firsts.
We were the first museum to do an exhibition of Pablo Picasso, the first to do a major exhibition of the surrealist artists in America. And we were the first to have a museum auditorium. And we commissioned Gertrude Stein's Four Saints and Three Acts, the first opera with an all-black cast.
But even after 170 years, the real mojo coming off these walls isn't about hanging on to tradition.
Welcome to our newly renovated Morgan Great Hall.
According to museum director Susan Talbot, the Athenaeum's history of firsts comes from a track record of taking risks.
And so we did something radical, the curators and I. We decided that we were going to install modern art in Morgan Great Hall. And so here we have Robert Rauschenberg's iconic painting, Retroactive One. You know, it's a kind of time capsule of a moment in history, and that moment was 1963.
In fact, the museum's MO on breaking the rules was first started by Daniel Wadsworth when he shook up the art world by showcasing the work of American artists from the Hudson River School.
The Wadsworth has an unparalleled collection of Hudson River School landscapes, which really give a panoramic view of the history of creativity in America from the colonial period right up through the present day.
Over the decades, that forward-thinking leadership has acquired an extraordinary collection, countless masters from the past and present. The visionary director Chick Austin brought groundbreaking drama, dance, and music inside the museum walls. The ongoing Matrix program continues as a showcase for emerging artists. And the museum's educational programs and special presentations are all centered on involving its community.
We want everyone to feel welcome when they walk into this museum. It's really a two-way street, bringing people here, but also going out into the community, like Museum on the Move, where our docents go into the schools, and then the kids come to the museum.
With five buildings and 50,000 works, the Athenaeum offers endless possibilities for exploring art. And with the help of a $30 million makeover, the museum has redesigned the way we see art, learn about it, and make connections.
When you put people in front of a still object, they're sometimes not as comfortable. It gives you a moment, though, to slow down, to be curious, to be imaginative, and engage in a conversation with a still work of art.
As its doors remain open, the museum-wide reinstallation is already turning heads, featuring new theme-driven exhibitions and creating interplay between the old and new.
In an encyclopedic museum, there has to be something for everyone. There are going to be things that the public loves, and there are going to be things that the public finds puzzling. And all of that is good.
As you walk, watch, and wonder, the Wadsworth Athenaeum keeps making sure it offers something special for everyone. Who knows? Falling in love with a hidden treasure might just become that secret passion that will change you forever.
George Washington not only slept in Wethersfield, Connecticut, but during his historic rendezvous with French General Rochambeau, he worshipped in the local Congregational Church, walked these streets, and spent 5 days as a guest in the home of Joseph and Abigail Webb. The Webb House is one of three historic homes nestled together on Main Street. All three houses are part of the Webb Dean Stevens Museum, which is owned and operated by the Colonial Dames. The Webb House was built in 1752 for 25-year-old merchant Joseph Webb and his 20-year-old bride Mehitable. The house epitomizes the mid-century elegance of Connecticut Valley river gods, whose refined lifestyles ushered in an era of affluence. The most famous event that took place at the Webb House was the historic meeting between General George Washington and French General Rochambeau in 1781.
The reason why this really important meeting took place in Wethersfield is because Wethersfield and Hartford are the halfway point between New York, where Washington was stationed, and Newport, Rhode Island, where Rochambeau was stationed.
Upstairs in the bedchamber is where General Washington slept and met with aides during his five-day stay in Wethersfield.
We restored it to look as it would have looked when Washington stayed here. Part of the restoration included regraining the woodwork. And another thing we did is we did scientific paint analysis of the original wallpaper. So we reproduced the original wallpaper. And also the upholstery was all redone en suite.
While General Washington and the Webbs slept comfortably in their chambers, the attic housed the family slaves. The primitive conditions remind visitors of the presence of enslaved domestic servants in colonial Connecticut.
This is the Southwest Parlor at the Webb House, and it's the room where we believe that General Rochambeau and General Washington and their aides met. The room doesn't really look the way it would have looked in the period because Wallace Nutting, a famous American antiquarian, acquired this house in 1916 and is responsible for hiring three Hartford artists to do these murals to commemorate this important event.
Next door is the mansion built for Silas Deane in 1770. This house reflects the flamboyance and ambition of its owner. Deane graduated from Yale in 1758 and represented Wethersfield in the General Assembly and the State of Connecticut in the Continental Congress.
Well, this Southwest Parlor is the largest room in the house, and you see that he's got very expensive, very high-style furniture and wonderful china. They also have this incredible Portland, Connecticut brownstone mantle, and I've never seen anything like this anyplace else.
Silas Deane's wife, Elizabeth Saltonstall Deane, brought two enslaved Africans to their marriage.
The two slaves that Elizabeth brought into the household were named Pomp and Hagar. The documents indicate that Hagar was the cook and Pomp was a handyman who was also a very good horseman.
To the north is the Stevens House, built in 1789 for a successful Wethersfield tanner named Isaac Stevens.
Although this house was built in the late 18th century, it is interpreted on the inside to the 1820s and 30s, and it reflects the lifestyle of an upper middle class family.
Eventually, Isaac Stevens' son's widow, Elizabeth, married Connecticut River captain Stephen Francis and raised their five children in the house.
This house reflects the changes that were occurring as a result of the Industrial Revolution, when consumer goods were much more available to the average family. You end up having wall-to-wall carpeting. Wallpaper was much less expensive and was available to these middle-class households.
Unlike the kitchens next door, the Stevens kitchen was not staffed by servants, but run by the women of the household. It also doubled as an office where the men kept accounts and managed the family's business affairs, a precursor to the modern-day family room. The second floor is devoted to children.
So we have one gallery that has a wonderful array of dollhouses and toys from the Colonial Dames collection. And we've accommodated four or five children in the bedroom with bright textiles and a lot of fun stuff.
The three historic homes sit on an 8-acre parcel of land, which includes the 1921 Colonial Revival Garden designed by Amy Cogswell, one of America's first female landscape architects. So if you want an authentic encounter with history, come and visit the Webb Dean Stevens Museum, a Connecticut cultural treasure.
Looming high above New Haven, the summit of East Rock Park, with its sweeping views of the city and Long Island Sound, a draw to both bikers and birds of prey, and just about anyone looking for an escape from the busy world below.
Citizens of New Haven have a great playground in their own backyard and can probably be here from almost any part of the city in 5 to 10 minutes.
The original intent of the Founding Fathers, who created this park at the end of the 19th century so stressed out citizens could connect to nature. It was designed by Donald Mitchell, a student of the famed landscape architect Frederick Law Olmsted, who was on a mission to carve out green spaces in the midst of urban environments caught up in the Industrial Revolution.
There was a feeling we were being disconnected with the outdoor world and nature. So Donald Mitchell correctly retained a lot of the natural features here.
The only man-made structure in the park's original design, the striking Sailors and Soldiers Monument, dedicated to New Haven citizens who lost their lives during the four major wars of the time. The Angel of Peace, perched on top, stands sentinel over the neighborhoods below.
So you did a renovation here when?
About 2 years ago. We secured the Angel of Peace more securely to her foundation. This hardware that we see here, it was all the original hardware to the doors back in 1887.
And you do get a little dizzy going around in circles.
Now visitors can trek the 88 steps to the very top. Humans, not the only ones drawn to East Rock's heights.
Those are ravens, the most intelligent bird on the planet. One of the reasons that this is one of the best places to observe migrating raptors is the fact that the raptors will actually utilize the mountain and the hot air rising off it to give them lift up into the sky so that they can glide to their next destination.
The ascent, not so effortless for those who hoof it. The trail to the top, called Giant Steps, for good reason. It takes about an hour to climb the rocky stairs, each one about 18 inches high.
Pretty much felt like my legs were gonna fall off.
The trail was hewn into the ridge when it was a quarry in the early 19th century. The other major draw at East Rock, roses, thousands of them.
This is a rose called American Pillar. It was developed around 1900.
The Party Rose Garden, home to 200 different varieties.
This is a very unusual color in that it comes out orange and kind of changes to an apricot as it goes. So the roses are actually multicolored. This rose was actually found in mud after Hurricane Katrina. They call it the Katrina Rose because it's supposed to symbolize survival.
And it smells great. You can.
Yes, it has a wonderful light scent.
The garden was donated by William Pardee in 1922 as a memorial to his mother.
It's built according to a style that's really no longer in use. It's a classic French design.
The center garden resembles a wedding cake, a favorite photo spot for bridal parties. The roses and all 425 acres maintained by the New Haven Parks Department. People can canoe and crab in the Mill River that wends its way through the park. They can picnic in popular College Park near Yale's campus. And more than a century after it was created, East Rock Park's original mission is still intact.
Nice walk, it's scenic, quiet, and this back road has no cars, so we can skate right down it.
Yeah, it's pretty much like perfect for me.
Travelers to the Bush Holly Historic Site, situated on the Mayanus River in the historic village of the Kos Kob section of Greenwich, will be transported into a world still vibrating to the rhythms of a distant age. The Bush Holly House offers visitors a dual interpretation of two distinct periods of American history, the post-American Revolution era and the age of American Impressionism. The Bush family was one of the wealthiest in 18th century Greenwich, and David Bush was a prosperous merchant.
David Bush had the rights to operate the mill on the lower landing here. This was a crucial place because it was just off the Mayanus River leading out to the Kos Kob Harbor, and the farmers brought their produce down here, and he in turn shipped it to New York and then brought back manufactured goods for the community.
David Bush married Sarah, his sister-in-law, in 1777. They raised their 15 children here during the turbulent Revolutionary War era, a time when David's refusal to sign the oath of fidelity to the Patriot cause led to the family's loss of social standing in the community. The parlor is presented now as it would have looked in about 1820. The furnishings blend features from the colonial and early national periods, Sarah Bush's older dining table contrasting with the next generation's updated carpeting, Franklin stove, and imitation wood graining. Like most members of the merchant elite at the time, Sarah and David Bush managed their large household and business interests with the help of enslaved Africans whose personal sleeping quarters were most likely located above the kitchen chamber.
The slaves were an integral part of this household, and they also were valuable contributors to the success of David Bush's businesses. At any given time, half of the household were African Americans. They included, for example, patients who gave birth to 6 children in this house.
After David Bush's death, Sarah had life use of 1/3 of the house, while her adult children occupied the rest. After a stroke in 1821, Sarah moved into a first-floor bedroom. 4 generations of the Bush family lived in this house until 1848, when, with no male heir to pass along the family business, the property went into bankruptcy. In 1882, Josephine and Edward Holly bought the home with the intention of operating it as a boarding house, and soon many artists associated with the Art Students League in New York City flocked to Kos Kob. The Holly House became the inspiration and muse for the important American painters of their age.
The Kos Kob Art Colony is important not just in terms of Connecticut art, but in the broader history of American art in general. 4 of the 5 artists who are considered the most important artists that we now call American Impressionists worked here in Kos Kob and did important work here. They were John Twachtman, Childe Hassam, Theodore Robinson, and J. Alden Weir.
For the generation of American artists rediscovering the beauty and wonder of country life, the painters of the Kos Kob Art Colony were there to capture a way of life along a New England seaport village that was slipping away. From 1890 to 1920, more than 200 artists and writers passed through these doors. They gathered here to paint and share progressive ideas about art and society. Entering the front hall, guests were transported into an artistic environment infused with a sense of place, past, and family, a kind of living history. The Hollies' daughter, Constant, married boarding artist Elmer McRae. They had twin daughters who became frequent models for their father and other artists. Communal living made the Holly House like summer camp, and guests came throughout the seasons with its close proximity to New York City. The Holly women worked hard to assure that everyone was well fed and comfortable. Upstairs is an impeccably restored working artist's abode, the studio of Elmer McRae. On the easel is a portrait of his wife, Constant Holly McRae. This studio provides a glimpse into the life, identity, and interests of the artist, including his passion for Japanese art, which was in fashion at the time. The best bedroom was where influential guests like Child Hassam and his wife Maud stayed. Hassam, now one of the most iconic personalities in American art, loved this room and found inspiration for his paintings and etchings in the classical elegance of the room's Federal-style mantelpiece. In 1913, Elmer McRae helped organize New York City's Armory Show, the first large exhibition of modern art in America. The show profoundly changed the work of many American artists, including McRae's, who completed Japanese Iris just 1 year after the show.
By the 1920s, American Impressionism was certainly very much passé. An artist would tend to settle in a place like Kaskab rather than come out to a boarding house.
The McRae's lived here for the rest of their lives. Constant Holly McRae sold the house to the Greenwich Historical Society in 1957. Today, the headquarters of the Greenwich Historical Society includes the National Historic Landmark Bush Holly House, restored gardens, an education center with adult and family programs, the Historical Society's archives, and the 19th century storehouse offering changing exhibitions to the public. The tempestuous times of the Revolutionary War years and the vibrant era of the Kaskab Art Colony are gone, but this unique historic site, with its compelling stories of generations of the Bush and Holly families, provides a vital bridge to our rich cultural past.
In between one of Connecticut's most beautiful town greens and the Long Island Sound sits the state's oldest house, a medieval marvel made of stone. The Henry Whitfield House has survived nearly four centuries in the town of Guilford.
We have a really neat house for you to go through, and on each floor you get to see different things.
Curator Mike McBride brings this very special house and the items in it to life.
It's really a house associated with the forming of a community.
Reverend Henry Whitfield led that community. He came from England with a group of Puritans to seek freedom from religious persecution. He lived in the home with his wife and children and became one of Guilford's founders.
People come to Guilford following Henry Whitfield, believing what he thinks is the right way to worship and what you should believe about infant baptism or whether you kneel when you receive the sacraments. These are things that people literally die over in the 17th century.
The old stone house with its medieval architecture also served as a fortress for the community, and it's really the only example outside of northern England where you can see this type of structure.
You generally don't go to a historic house and find out that we can't tell you very much about the people who lived here. It's almost the opposite of why historic houses are generally saved. And while Henry Whitfield was important, this house was primarily saved because of the house.
Inside the home, you can experience how life was during the early days of Guilford, from beds with ropes to cooking utensils to artifacts related to famous events and people like Benedict Arnold and William Leete. This chair was owned by the first graduate of Yale College, John Hart. One of the most notable pieces is the Parmalee clock. It was the first steeple clock made in the colonies in 1726, and people from all over the world come to the museum just to see it.
We're going to prime the pan with some priming powder here off the cartridge.
Volunteers dress in period costume to educate visitors about various historical events, like the War of 1812.
They come down here as a naval impression of what a gunner that served aboard some of the sloops of war or the frigates of war that sailed around this part of Connecticut to oppose the British blockade.
On the grounds, visitors can also see a ship's cannon from that same war. So what was life like in this community nearly 400 years ago? Some of the answers can be found here in the museum's research library, from old patterns and textiles to more curious items.
We have a book called The Burgess Bill of Mortality, and it was this gentleman's hobby to record everyone who died in Guilford in a little diary.
With a flashlight and a game sheet, these important stories are being kept alive for younger generations.
One of the things you can do is a scavenger hunt game, and it has pictures of different things, because there's a lot of things in the house.
Children really get a sense of the good old days, realizing that life was a lot harder back then.
I learned what the old people had when they had it. They didn't have heaters or lights.
We found a sewing machine that was actually, it wasn't a machine. A person had to do it. You couldn't plug it in.
And as for the beds?
One had like a key where like you could adjust the ropes.
According to these kids, it's a trip worth taking.
It's really cool and it's really old and you should go there sometime.
Although the house has gone through many changes, the building and the site are a good vehicle for talking about a time period that is often forgotten, when the sacrifices of the first settlers helped pave a better life for future generations. For Connecticut Cultural Treasures, I'm Pat Lurie.
Thanks for letting us share our state's treasures with each of you. Until our next visit, I'm Edward Spicky for Connecticut's Cultural Treasures.
Funding for Connecticut's Cultural Treasures is provided by CPTV, Connecticut Tourism, the State Historic Preservation Office, Melinda and Paul Sullivan, People's United Bank, What Know-How Can Do, and the following contributing sponsors.